Well, you're really good people to come in with the weather so nice. I said, who's coming inside to listen to this stuff? Nice to see you. Appreciate that. And already he's got two things I like here, Mark. He's got name Quest, because my band, still active band with Byrack and Billy Hart, Ron McClure, is called Quest, so I'm already on your side. Plus he has my soprano, the Liebman soprano, Kyleworth, so that's nice. As I understood it, I mean, how many saxophone players? Okay. So before we get more general about jazz, and of course, please, any questions at all times to any of the gentlemen, I'll introduce them before we play. Please are welcome, and in fact, will help us go to what you want. But there's something I like to do sometimes with saxophone, without going into the whole lesson stuff. You know, my stuff's widely available on video and DVDs and all that stuff. And my teacher was Joe Allard, and those of you who know the genealogy, might know that he was a teacher in New York City, Juilliard, Manhattan School of Music, etc. And myself, Steve Grossman, Michael Brecker, Eric Dolphy, Harry Carney, a lot of people took lessons with Joe. So if you want to know what I know, you go to Joe Allard's and you see what he had to say. Basically, my principles of playing really come almost directly from him, paraphrased in my way, of course. So you can get that anywhere you want if you're interested. But there's something I like to do because it's a place with saxophones, and that is to talk about sound and how we describe the undescribable. How do you describe what you can't touch and what you can't see? Painting, we can talk about it because it says red, blue, blah, blah, blah. A book, we can pore over the words. Sculpture, we can even touch. But when you go, it's out there somewhere, and that's another discussion, of course, where it is. But we are musicians, and everybody in this room who's dealing with music in any way, even just a good, serious listener, is really talking about sound. And getting further to talk about sound, in other words, a little bit more in detail, just in general, say the word sound, it's like saying food. That's okay, but if you want to eat something tonight, you got to know which kind of restaurant you want to go to. So often I find it's challenging and interesting for a little audience participation in this respect to discuss sound. And one way of doing it is what we deal with a lot, and saxophone players, I don't have to tell you this, but just try an instrument. Everybody knows that experience. Coming to a place like this, being confronted with 3 to 4 to 5 different horns in the category you're looking for, and going inside a room or wherever and trying to play and trying to tell the difference between them. Sound-wise, I'm not talking, obviously this has mechanics, I'm not going to talk about that right now. And sometimes it's a little confusing. I know it was confusing for me when I was in that stage of my life looking for reeds and mouthpieces. Horns you don't do every day, it's expensive. Mouthpieces in those days were $50, $75, so you could afford them. And you know, you would try a mouthpiece and you have your friend listen to you, and you know, et cetera, et cetera. And even with reeds, I wasn't sure if reeds was a variable. So I had to buy, anytime there was a new brand available, this was New York at that time, the 60s, if it was, you know, Symmetrica, Pasta times two, I mean, it all sounded like a menu anyway. I said, I got to get at least 2 to 3 reeds, because who knows if one is bogus, then it's not being fair to the reed. Which is the best reed for me? So I would lay out 2 to 3, I'd go to Manny's, I would buy every box of any reed that was in the category, go home with like 12, 14 reeds, be like 6 or 7 different brands, and try to test them. So when you're doing something like that, trying horns, trying mouthpieces, trying reeds, of course the first aspect, which I just alluded to, is the physical aspect. Feels good, fingers feel nice, the action's cool, the horn feels good or not good, or it's a little awkward, or the positioning, we were talking about the keys on the alto and stuff. Okay, that's number one. That is a personal thing. Everybody's body is different. How it feels to you is going to be different from everybody next to you. So that's understood. But the sound thing is a little bit more ambiguous. So what I like to do for this little thing is play these horns. Now, let's start with the sopranos. This is my soprano, but Mark has my soprano for sale here. I don't know if anybody's played it. Maybe it's been tested or something like that. And of course, it'd be interesting to see how consistent the brother is.
That's right.
But let's see in that case. And in fact, do you have another one? What's the one you said I should try here? What'd you say?
The old one?
Yeah, what'd you say?
The large bore summer?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's do that too. So we'll do 3 sopranos. First, we'll see if truly Kyleworth is living up to the name of the quality of the Liebman soprano and keeping things in the pocket, if you get my point. So I'm gonna take advantage of having a couple Kiowas around. Okay, I don't know if you want to put it on the stand. Is that all right? All right, let's see, first of all, let's compare the two Kiowas. So I'm gonna ask you what you hear, okay? All right, and not content. I'm not gonna play any magical lines, no mystery. I'm just gonna play like a beginner, just up and down the horn. You want to test all the ranges, of course. You eventually want to test the overtones, things like that. But even before you get there, you hit it. You try to play something that'll be more or less the same on all of them. Various inputs, energy-wise and breath-wise. Okay, keep that thought. This is an embarrassment of riches, man. Shit. A chance to do this at home? One at a time. Let's call that number one and call this number two.
Brighter, more centered.
Everybody agree with that?
Yes.
I like it. It's more clearer.
Clearer. Okay, so now. Okay, this is what we're doing. We're doing this because of vocabulary. At least in this room, it's all English. I go to other places, I obviously have a problem. My translator has to be hip, otherwise this whole discussion is off the map. But in this case, clear, scented, bright. Do they all mean the same thing? Or the clear means, what my friend is saying is clear, is that the same thing that he's saying is bright? Or are we having a perception difference or a vocabulary
clear,
difference?
Bright, I think that would be similar. Centered is a little bit different.
Centered is a little bit different.
It's different.
Uh-huh. So centered, like young lady is saying, centered is different from bright. Everybody like that? So what do we mean by centered? Not you. Centered, somebody else. What do we mean when we say the sound? Because you've heard this word.
Well, yeah? It's the way the sound is projected in a more bundled or more focused way.
Whoa, look at her, man. Big hug. I'm taking you with me there. You're talking straight. That's great. Bundled. I never heard that word about sound, but that means a packet, I believe. Maybe a little center like that. I like to think about it, centered being always good to know one word is how the other word, the opposite sounds, and that helps you out. Scented compared to spread, a spread sound. Now, in the old days, of course, this is not sopranos in most cases because it wasn't such a common instrument, but the older guys, remember, didn't have microphones. Or if they did, the sound system was pretty lame, even in a place like Birdland, believe me. And in the, my time, the 60s, but certainly it was worse, I'm sure, before that. And I remember having this discussion with Joe Allard about centered sound, because the sound that sounds clearer, centered, brighter, I agree is a different thing, but the sound that is clearer, or let's say centered, is to the player louder. To me, it's clearer than the spread. But for you out in the room, there's a difference. For the listener, if I'm doing the spread sound, I mean, I'm being very, figurative about something, again, talking about sound, hard one to do, but I'm talking about kind of like the sound being like that. So if you're all sitting on the edge, you're sitting on the edge, everybody's getting an equal dose. But when the sound is centered, not meaning qualified, when the sound is centered, there's the appearance and the feeling from the player of more of a, maybe clearer, maybe brighter, maybe, but definitely more projection. And I remember having this discussion with Joe about mouthpiece openings, which has a lot to do with this situation. And at that time, when I was young, just like most young guys, you do more than you should. I was playing as big opening as I could. I couldn't get something bigger than 10. And I was playing a 5 reed in those days. I don't know what it was, Rico, whatever was available, whatever I was using. And I was working really hard. Remember, I'm 17, 18 years old, and that's part of the game when you're that age. I go into Joe, and he said, "You're killing yourself. You're working way too hard." I said, "You ain't gonna last doing that." He said, "Because you think that the sound, you think it's gonna be more like this, it's more spread out." He said, "But remember, you got a microphone." He said, "And if your core of your sound is there, everybody's gonna be fine. So think about trying to get a bigger spread and raising your mouthpiece to a 15 opening with an 18 reed," which is kind of what I wish I could have done. And that was a good lesson. It kind of changed my perception of this situation of centered versus spread, and that's an important thing. Now, of course, there's the Sonny Rollins story that these gentlemen have heard many times, which is very apocryphal. First of all, the greatest saxophone player who ever lived, number one, was in a hotel with a friend of mine in Chicago. He's playing one place, playing another place. And just like you might ask your friend or your associates, like I bother him all the time, I bother my wife all the time, what's the difference between A, B, and C, like we just did? Because I can't tell. Because you know one thing about this thing. You play a saxophone, you play a horn, you never hear it like the whole rest of the world hears it. You spend your whole life playing and you never really hear it. You hear a tape of it, but that's a tape. It means a microphone that's already biased. So no one ever hears, you never hear yourself the way you're hearing me. You're right in the line of fire. You're in the line of fire. You're almost in the line of fire. So of course, when you're trying mouthpieces and horns, you're bound to want to say, "Can I get a little helpful opinion over here? How about, what does it sound like to you? What does it sound like to you?" When I would do that with Joe, he would stand 20 feet in back of me. I said, "Why aren't you over here?" He said, "No, no, I'll be in back of you over here, over here." So Sonny Rollins calls my friend, whoever that was. I thought it was Pat LaBarbera, but it wasn't. And he says, "Selma, near Chicago in Elkhart, wherever this is, in South Bend, wherever you are. I have 4 tenors that they gave me to try." Now, that's not unusual for somebody like that. You know, he's in town. Would you try my horns? That's what I'm doing here. So the guy is flipping out. Could you imagine Sonny Rollins calling you to give your opinion on his sound? That's like God asking you to dinner. That's God asking you to dinner. You know what I mean? So the guy's flipping, okay? So he goes up, of course, right across the bed or the couch or whatever it was. There's 4 brand new Selmas wrapped up, and, you know, blah, blah. Sonny says, "Thank you for coming," you know, that voice he has and everything. And the guy's flipping out. He's excited because, you know, when you listen to somebody play, you often, you know, you'd be looking at their fingers like you're going to steal it. You're going to get what they get, but you can't get anything from their fingers, but you can't help but look at their fingers. You know, I would say, don't look at the fingers. Look at the embouchure to learn something. The fingers, you know what's going on, but it's a natural thing. Say, "That stuff you played on Saxophone Colossus at bar 42 of course 8. That's it." You know, okay. So he's in there. Sonny takes out the first horn, plays low B flat. Plays low B flat, plays low B flat, plays only low B flat for 45 minutes on the 4 tenors. Of course, in between, he's saying to my man, "What you think of that one? Is that centered, dark? Who knows what he's saying?" You know what I mean? So, what's the lesson there? The only real note on the saxophone is B flat. And to really be honest about it, in the end, of course, it's brass, not like wood. You know, we're not looking for like grenadier, and, you know, rubber tree wood, whatever special exotic woods we have, and we have clarinets and oboes and all that stuff. It's brass, it's man-made, you know, it's what it is. But in a certain way, when I played what I just did, I should just be playing low B-flat and then ask you what you think. Of course, that's not quite realistic, is it? Right. Okay, let's do that one more time. Switch it around. Sure he's not moving anything, try to put it on the same place in the horn, so you're keeping all the variables as uniform as possible. number two. Let's call this now number one, and that number two. Any differences? This is my horn.
Well, I find
That's the shop horn. That's going to be somebody going to cop someday.
I find it to be fuller.
I agree, and that's why I play it. That's why it's 001. Because I told them right there, I got to pick a five. If you want me to sign this deal, I want five horns in front of me. So they came up with three. Always ask for more, get them more. And I tried all three, and by the way, I tell you the story of this horn, how this horn came to being. I mean, I've been playing Kyleworth, which were originally Cuff, C-O-U-F, gentleman from Pittsburgh, Herb Cuff, beautiful man, who I met at one of the IAJE conventions, if you recall. I think we had one, yeah, that time I was here. And Herb was a clarinet player, but he spoke perfect German, war, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, he goes to Germany, and he meets Mr. Kyleworth, Julius Kyleworth, you know, who's been making saxophones from 1930s. Out near Czechoslovakia, very old one. And he says, I have ideas for saxophone, I'd love to go into business, blah, blah, blah. So Cuff was the original horn that I played, and that's from the late 70s. Now, I don't know, maybe you know, Mark, but I don't know anybody else who stayed with the company for 40 years. And the reason's very simple. I really like the sound, especially on the low register. These horns have a low register to die for. Tenor, which we'll get to in a minute, and the soprano especially, and you know the soprano problem among several problems, the soprano challenge is to get a deep sound and try to take the shrillness, the natural shrillness of the left hand away. That's true of the alto also, but it's very true on an instrument up an octave, first of all, and as narrow as this with so much air going in. So you got some technical things that make it the way it is. So of course, I would be drawn to a horn that has a deeper sound, especially in the bottom register, and that's kind of the main thing. So after 20, 30 years playing it, very nice company, they had their ups and downs, sold, resold, you know, who knows the whole story, because the deal has been on this at the beginning. But now it's a buffet, and it's ensconced pretty well, and they're doing pretty good. And about 6-7 years ago, I said to the rep, I said, you know, man, if you want to hold on to me, you got to make a Liebman horn, soprano. I've been doing you for 30 years, and you know, I'm one of the experts on this instrument. I want a horn made for me, and if not, I'm going to jump shit in a minute. And it happened to be at that time that the Selma guy was on my case, and so was Yamaha. It just happened to all come together. So I actually did have the potential to jump ship, you know, at least appear that way. So they said, cool, and they went for it. It's about 2006. And what they did is they hired a guy, Benedict Eppelsheim, who you know, of course, who is a instrument maker, of strange instruments, soprello, which is an octave above the soprano. It's this big. He has a contra. What's the big one he makes? It's like bigger than
sub-contra.
So he's an instrument inventor. Five people in Munich, you know, obviously a specialist. They called him in and they hired him, which is a good faith. Shows good faith. Of course, we can see that they put money out. They hired him to work with me. Now, the most important part of the horn is going to be the top part, the tapering and the measurements. I'm not a technical guy like that. He's much better at these things. But definitely, something's happening on the top that's going to probably pervade the whole horn. Bottom register, not, you know, allowing for that, as I spoke about. But in general, it's the top part of the horn. So what he did is, now you probably, some of you play sopranos with detachable necks, right? You know, where you put the neck in, and I'm not talking about curved neck, straight neck. And of course, it's seems like a luxury, because you're going to have a gold neck, a brass neck, and now, you know, Kyleworth has 18 different necks. That's great. But I've always been told, I'm not sure if it's true, your repairman might know this, and I take it for being true, that when you have the changeable necks, you are taking more possibility of leaks being created around where the neck goes in. Is that an old wives' tale? Is that superstition?
Yeah, it's very true.
Okay. Enough for me to say, I don't want a horn with changeable necks. So what he did, for the sake of creating the horn that I could try, he made like 10 necks, and he followed me around for the next 3 years. Anytime I was in Germany or near Munich, he would come to the gig, he would bring a bunch of necks. I'd go A, B, head letters, A, B, C, D, E. I'd say number A, G, just like we just did, like, you know, Sonny Rollins. And like A, I don't know, B, C, D, centered, blah, blah, blah. And finally, it came together. And just since we're talking about horns, before we go to the tenor, or to the other soprano, when I get the question, which of course I do, is what's the difference between Kiowarth and Selma? You got to deal with Selma. That's the 800-pound gorilla in the room. You got to deal with that. And Yamaha to a certain degree. And then all the others, the Bogani and the what's the other one, Italy? There's a million in Italy. Ramponi, blah, blah, blah. The Kiowarth is a German horn. Do I need to say any more?
Nine.
The difference between the Kiowarth and the soprano is the difference between a Panzer tank and the best perfume in the world. That'll tell you everything. You're not going to get a tank out of France, but you ain't going to get no damn perfume out of Germany. So when you're playing a Selma, and again, this is a big statement because Selma's have a whole history. He knows every serial number. And, you know, there's guys walking around with 22,418 being the horn. In general, a Selma is a very even, I would say lighter, comparatively, clarity, balanced, wonderful keyboard, depending, and then we get into which ones are better and so forth. But it's a beautifully made horn. I'm talking about 100 years of history, or whatever, that upstairs, you know. I mean, in general, a well-made instrument, that's all. Yamaha, of course, Japanese. I started with this stuff in the 70s. I was there with Miles the first time I was in Japan. Guy had three guys with notebooks letting me try horns, and they gave me a horn for my time, you know, because sopranos were just starting to be made. Very well-made Yamaha, no real personality, but very serviceable and absolutely cool to play, especially if you're a doubler. And then there's Kiowarth, which definitely has a personality. And depends on, this is what I say, to certainly on a soprano, to a lesser extent, but still true with a tenor. When you have a horn with a personality versus a horn, I'm not saying that someone doesn't have a personality, but it's a little more evenly made. When you have a horn that has a personality, like I'm sure you've tried, when you've gone into stores, you pick up a horn, you go like, something about this horn, that's special. Then it becomes an aesthetic choice on your part as to how much you want to put into it. Because if it has a personality, you can either play ball with that personality or work against it. If you work against it, you might as well get away from it. You have to take the advantage that the horn gives you and make something out of it, if that's what you want to do. And I always tell the guys, especially with soprano, if you're going to be a doubler and you're picking up soprano to play a couple tunes and a part and whatever, show or whatever, I wouldn't get a Kiowarth. I wouldn't do it. Because it's a little more work. It takes a little bit more air, really, literally. And it has a personality. And if you pick up a Yamaha or a Selma, you pretty much can play it right away. You don't have to work too hard. You don't have to worry about doubling, you know, and that's the thing. So that's really the difference. It is not a qualitative difference. It is a descriptive difference. And it's a matter, again, of, you know, wine from this country or wine from that country. That's your preference. Still good wine. If it's good, it's good. So that's the point. Let me try this. What do you say this is?
It's a large bore.
What does that mean, large bore? Like Kiowarth large bore? What do you mean, this?
The Model 22 and 26 that came before it were the more pea shooters. The large bore is the first one that had a larger bore. Your Kiowarth is probably a larger bore than that.
I hope so.
For its time, it was a large bore.
For its time.
Right. And that's how they advertised it, so that name was
I didn't know. So what year is this?
That's about 1930.
Oh, wow. 8,961.
Yeah, it's an old
one. Wow. Well, the oldest ones are those that I play, the 1927 Buescher. You know, those are remarkable. So.
Buescher's and Kahn.
Kahn, yeah, beautiful. They were so well made. Oh, it's so small, it's amazing. It's nice. It's nice. Of course, when you go to something that's 100 years old, your fingers are going to get caught up. Same with tenors, and then we'll play a little bit for you. Now, these are not, I don't carry tenor. I get tenor du jour. with this band, I don't play tenor, so tonight there'll be no tenor. It's nice to play there. It's a couple of weeks. There's Selma folklore. Tell you two aspects of it. One is, of course, the original, the balanced action, which are considered in general as the best keyboards. This is a keyboard ever made. The balanced actions feel like glass. Just feel great. And almost every balanced action I play just feels great. I have one. I have a 29,000 one. It's fantastic. Then I had an incident in Boston, very famous repairman, Emilio Lyons. I know Mark knows him, who is now retired, but still working actually. Great, great guy, killer, took care of everybody. I was in the shop, and by chance, Wayne was in town, and Wayne said, try my horn, tenor. It was the best horn I ever played, and it was like a 40 or 39,000, okay? I asked Emilio after Wayne left, you know, I said, Emilio, what's the story on Wayne's horn? And what is the story on the Selmas anyway? You should know by now. I mean, you know, of course. He said, the best horns ever made are between 38,000 and 42,000. This is the early super, what's it, super?
Super
balanced. So after balance, super balanced before the Mark VI. And it goes to like 52,000, something like that. And then they start the Mark VI, somewhere in the early 50s. And then I had another chance to play one, a gentleman who lives near us, where we live, Adam Nywood, saxophone player. He has same vintage, 39,000, 40,000, and it was fantastic. So those are horns that are very special. Then you get into the Mark VI, and the Mark VI begins around 55, 60,000, and works its way up and keeps going. I don't know, when did it stop? 150, 180,000?
200,000.
200,000. Basically, up to around 90, 100 is what we're talking about. And most guys, if they say Mark VI, and that's why I always ask serial number. It's like saying your identity card, please. Because as soon as you tell me it's 82,000 or 66,000 or 75,000, we're in that zone of like, this could be important to great horns. And that's kind of the reputation of Selma. And after that, it's not the same. And this reference and the 54 and all that, forget about it. Not even on the same map. I don't know. They said the brass is different. I don't know. I figured they didn't drink the right wine at lunch. Because, you know, French, you have wine at lunch. I was at the factory, man. This guy, they got a 2-hour lunch. I said, don't you think that affects what you do at 3 o'clock? Oh, no, brother, this is how we get into it. I said, so therefore, if the horns were different from 40 years ago, maybe the wine was different. Anyway, to finish the discussion, sound and describing sound. There's a portion in my book, the very first part, the developing personal saxophone sound. Mark, do you have that book here? Anybody have that book on? There's a page in there where I talk about the description of sound from the Chinese sages. Again, I don't know if it was Chinatown or real China, but good enough to use. And the sounds, the words, subtleness, resonance, breathiness, they have like seven qualities of sound. And when I do my master class, I start with that. And I say, who is a happy sound? What jazz musicians are a happy sound on saxophone? You all listen to jazz? Who? He's always number one. Anywhere I go, it's the first name that comes out. It's incontestable, 100% across the board. When you hear Cannonball Adderley, it's a happy sound. Oh, what is a happy sound? I mean, my kid is happy, smiling, and having pizza. Okay, happy. Is that the same happy? What is it? Happy. What is a happy sound? And then there's another one. Sweet. Hello, sweet. Stan Getz, thank you. Paul Desmond. I mean, it's like syrup. Chet Baker on trumpet. Right? This is not what they play, although, of course, it's tied in. It's hard to divorce what they play with what they sound like, but sound-wise, tone-wise. So when you're listening to somebody, or, you know, or yourself, or whatever, teaching yourself like that, I think it's a good thing to think in these terms at some point. This spread bright, dark light, breathy, airy, sweet. I mean, you know, every name that is an adjective we could put onto sound. And to just be able to, in your mind, for the sake of clarification, to be able to describe sound to yourself. Of course, if you have kids, students, and everything, that's got to do that. That's part of your job. But I'm saying first starts with home, and like that sound is brighter in the left hand, darker in the right. You know, you really got to get in there with this stuff. And let me just finish this discussion with equipment, not to put the brothers out of business. But an amateur always blames his tools, and that's the difference between an amateur and a professional. It's not that you play for 30 years. It's that a professional knows it's on him or her, and it ain't the damn instrument. Now, obviously, if I drive a 1954 Chevy that's breaking down, it's different than if I, you know, have a 2015 Mercedes as far as operation goes. Obviously, and are there going to be things and so forth and so on? That's not what I'm talking about. That's, you know, characteristic of the horn. That's the way they made them. Point is that you shouldn't be blaming your reeds and your equipment, because let me tell you something. You could be here all day spending money on everything, neck straps. Cats have whole philosophies about this part of the neck strap vibrating.
No.
Yes, sir. David Sanborn. You talk to David Sanborn, he'll tell you about all the straps and the way they vibrate. And he ain't talking straight life, man. Ain't no bull. He's talking straight life. So, but look, we got a lot of equipment. Saxophone is almost on up to guitar or drums in a way, as far as stuff we have for every need. And of course, we need to do that. You need cork grease, and you need mouthpiece, and you need a spring, you need a ligature, you need a cap. Can't even get a cap to fit these things anymore, you know, etc. But do not be, what's the word, blinded by science, like Thomas Dolby used to. If you're going to be blinded by science, that means that the instrument is getting in your way, and do not blame the instrument. Let me tell you something. Everything's about here, and about here, and about here, and mostly about here and here. And that's the story. And of course, get yourself straight. Don't play something that puts you at a disadvantage, obviously. But once you get neutral, with a decent teacher, 2-3 years of playing, you get an understanding of what's going on, you get your equipment. I wouldn't spend the kind of fortunes and money. Bill Evans is selling a mouthpiece for $1,600. I couldn't believe it. I called the brother. I said, how do you do that? He said, people buy it? My old lady flipped. She said, how come you don't have something like that? I got a horn, but I don't get no $1,600 when that sells. Be careful with equipment. Don't be blinded by it. That's all I'm saying. It's the principles of playing. I mean, I could take your horn, Matt. We could take anybody's horn in here a couple of minutes. We could play it. I could even play your mouthpiece and reeds. Maybe soft, maybe hard. But you learn how to, because we know how to, what the principles are, so you learn how to adjust. So don't let that get in the way and have a good time with it. Any questions about this discussion? Yes, sir.
I got two questions.
first one is everything that you're planning there.
Arsenal.
Yeah. Could you kind of theoretically analyze what you were doing and what you were thinking?
Playing? I mean, what I played?
Well, everything that you were just doing just now.
You're talking about...
Obviously, these are just kind of like brainstorming.
You're talking about playing or talking? Are you talking about playing or talking?
Huh?
Are you talking about playing what I played or what I'm saying?
When you're playing.
I'm just warming up.
Yeah, but what are you thinking about?
Well,
that's
nothing. No, nothing. Now when I don't go in and play it. I don't play a tune when I'm trying to horn. I mean,
are you thinking of a key?
No. But I am trying to cover, for the sake of practical sake, cover the horn, cover the altissimo, cover the high register, cover the low, play the overtones to see if it's in tune, fairly in tune without getting too crazy about it. I go out, see how the agility is, and see how the response is on low, middle, and high, basically. I mean, it's pretty obvious. It's, you know, it's ABC stuff. But, you know, and I can tell in about a minute what the horn is. I don't need more than a couple of minutes. I don't even need a couple of minutes. But you don't want to sit there and think about what you're playing. If you're trying horns, you want to cut your variables out. I don't want to worry about what I'm playing. I worry about that every day. I just want to play the horn. Move your fingers, you can play chromatics, anything, doesn't matter. But definitely high to low, and definitely loud and soft. Absolutely push it, absolutely play soft. See if you can play subtone, assuming it covers. So you know you have your dynamic range, you have your articulation range, although that's more mouthpiece. And I like to check the overtones to see if the intonation's right. And I also like to be, you know, cognizant of the left hand on every horn that it's not too bright. See the change of color on an A? Just, I mean, usually when I do this with Stu, we go note by note, half steps, and then major thirds and minor thirds matching the sound. But for the sake of the ease here, just notice how the sound changes. Obviously from here. Obviously, D is different, another world. It's a terrible note, too. You know, rough note. T, by the way, add the palm D if you want to open it up. You know that one. Add the palm D to your regular D for clarity. For speed, you wouldn't do it necessarily, but clarity anyway. And that's like another horn, right? So the left hand around A, more or less by A, could happen to G, G sharp, but around A, and it's probably technical reasons that I don't understand. There's definitely a change of color in the horn. And you want to, like, know that, number one, recognize it. And number two, not when you're testing horns to go by, you don't have time, but you would probably want to work on evening that out. Joe's whole thing was that you should sound like the same saxophone player from the bottom to the top. He said when he would listen to me play, he'd say, you're three at one. I said, what? He says, you're three guys at the same guy. He says, you got a sound at the bottom, which most of us have, because bottom is bottom. You got a middle register that's something. And then you got that high register that don't sound like the same guy. So you're completely uneven throughout the horn. And that's why he does the overtone matching exercise. The one where I play the overtones and match the sound. Say, okay, so now we got a little problem, right? You hear the difference in the sound of the B flat, my regular fingering? I use side B flat. Let's take that out of picture. Let's do B. Now, if I didn't think about that, this is how that would have sounded. So this is called a matching exercise, and it is the fundamental, obviously low B flat, B, C, whatever you're on that day. The overtone would be octave first. What would be the next one? Fifth above that, right? Next one, a fourth above, two octaves above the original, blah, blah, blah. And you want to match the sound of the Sonny Rollins low B flat. Now you listen to this. Just listen to this. Resonance is completely gone. Well, it's obvious why, because I'm not covering the whole tube. That's what Sonny was talking about. Like that. So you want to get everything to be a low note. Your whole life is meant to be a low note. You can get everything to sound like a low note, with its warmth and darkness and whatever quality it has, you're cool. You're standing on solid ground. If you go up to high register and you sound like a, you know, out of control, and usually bright, too bright. I mean, that's usually the word I would use. And it's especially true on soprano, less on alto, even less on tenor and baritone. I don't even know because it's so low anyway. But You want to be sure that there's some sort of matching in the high register and low register. Now, if it's you that's a problem, don't blame the horn. That probably is not the horn. It's you controlling it. Because there's a definite change here of what's going on. High F, everything's open. Nothing's vibrating high F. The horn's done right here. So those are some of the challenges. Any other questions? Yes, sir. I was with Archie Shepp last week in this repair store in New York. He was getting that national dump. Thank you. And I got it on my phone, actually. He plays double lip. We say that's called double lip. Some people call it double embouchure. No teeth on top, just lip. Of course, your teeth at the bottom, somehow you have to hold the horn. And when you put your teeth on top, and my friend is explaining it really clear, you get, first of all, a very different feeling in the throat. It's a nice, open feeling, which is kind of what we're looking for. But you lose a little control on top register. Now, Archie has made an art out of that. I don't know how familiar you are with Archie's music. But when he goes up in that register, he's got a way of playing it. It's up to you how you want to describe it, but it's definitely different, let me tell you. And as soon as you take your teeth off, could you show them, you're good at this. Show them that. Show them with your teeth on and your teeth off. And play the whole shit.
Teeth on?
Teeth on, like normal, like everybody. Like normal. Teeth off, just double lip. Go up into the altissimo and play the crazy shit. Yeah, you get a whole bunch of different stuff in the high register. But notice how his sound changed. It was much warmer, but it's harder to control the pitch in the high register. So teeth on top is probably what most of us do. Most of us have an indentation. Because we probably are biting down too hard. Because there's a natural tendency to want to drop your head. And of course, the first lesson you give to a kid, by the way, if not you, certainly to a kid, is, you know, with the tenor, I mean, keep your head up. That's all. If you see the brother like, oh, I have a little girl doing that, she's going like, you're not talking to me like that. Why are you playing like that? I'm not down there. Oh, no, sorry, sir. Talk like that. Well, now when you play the horn, bring the horn to you. That's what this does. Don't be leaning over. That don't look hip. Even though it kind of looks him. I used to do it because it looked him. I thought Dexter doing it right in front of me. And he had that beautiful low register. I said, I guess I got to drop my jaw. You know? And then Joe goes, he says, if you drop your jaw, he says, look what you're doing in your vocal cords. Listen to my voice change. Listen to it. The difference between this and the difference between that. Projection. He says, so don't be an idiot and do that shit. You know what I mean? Double lip is, I mean, it's a way of playing. And it's a taste thing, and it's a matter of style, and it's not wrong. It's if it works for you, it's right. But one thing that you did admit, and it's been interesting, you went back to teeth on top, and they were much lighter. And that is one of the reasons you should practice double lip. Now, you may not ever use it, but it should be part of your routine because it does give you the feeling of no pressure on top. And then when you go back to the real world with the teeth on top, like normal playing, you've already experienced a lighter touch. So it can't be harmful to practice double lip.
Okay, so if I wanted to play the double, which is the lip, at what point do I use my lip? Above half sharp, or when should I play my teeth and I'm gonna play a high F? When do I change for the lip? Do I, above high F?
Need to go back to teeth?
No, for the high notes, above high F, do I?
Now, if I put my teeth on top, you get a real vocalization. See, so if you play like Archie plays like that, he told me he had to do that because he had dentures and he couldn't put any pressure on his teeth anymore. That's the way he does it. You know, and if your teeth start going on you, at our age, that happens. You may have to end up with double lip. You know what I'm saying? You ain't got no choice in that matter. But again, in general, I would ask you to do what I just did, you know, and play and fool around too, and have fun with it. But the altissimo register really changes in character. It gets much less focused, it gets more spread out, and you get that vocalization that you hear when you're like, I mean, look, Train didn't play double lip, but he had that vocalization. But if you want to really have it like Archie has it, some of the other avant-garde players, you just put double lip on top. You do that, man, you're going to get some shit, I'll tell you right now. I mean, they may throw you out of the damn place, but you're going to get some shit. That's all. Any other questions? I hope I answered you. Yes, sir.
How you
doing, bro? Well, that's what we were just doing. I don't know if you came in, but I try to feel the clicking, you know, how the action feels. But again, remember the action can be fixed, so that's not a, if I don't like the action, he'll fix it for me. I just play hard in it, I play soft in it, I play fast on it, I play slow on it, I play in the upper register, I play in the low register. I just test everything possible that I would play, and whatever sounds to me the best. I might use a little assistance by somebody out there to help me and say, what do you think about number two? You think number three is too bright, blah, blah, blah. But in the end, it's how it feels to you and how it sounds to you. And that's why also you do it a good way is against the wall, in the closet type thing. I mean, you do hear it, against the wall is about the best you can do for hearing it, you know. But then, it, you know, see with horns, you can't learn about a horn in a half hour. It's, you know, it's an instrument, it's, you know, it's an acquired taste. And best is if they loan it to you for 30 days and you know, you gotta get used to it. And then you learn how to control it. Anything else? Yes, sir, one more and then we play.
How much do you think that sense is worth?
Ask him. He's the one selling them. I ain't selling them. Okay, this is Matt Vashlishin on the reeds. Tonight you'll see all the reeds. Please welcome him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thanks to Bobby Avey on piano.
Yeah.
Alex Ritz is on drums and tonight percussion. And on the e-bass today, this is Tony Marino. Of course, tonight we'll be playing our music, our program. We've had an interesting little tour. This is our last gig. We're driving home at 3 in the morning, I guess. We have a long way back to the East Coast. But last two gigs, we are stuck with the equipment that is handed to us. You don't carry basses around anymore. You don't carry drums around. The old days, cats were strapped to the roof, you know. The train went to the West Coast and Elvin's drums were strapped to the roof. You don't do that no more. You depend on the place and the venue to have something for you if they give a shit. And the last two nights we've had, if you know anything about drums are measured, bass drums, pretty important part of drum kit I would imagine, are measured in their inches. And the preferred jazz inch set is, because Elvin and everybody, is an 18 inch, possibly a 20, rarely a 22. Guess what we had the last two nights in Nashville and wherever the night before was, somewhere in Georgia. We had 22 inch. Now that puts Alex in a certain perspective right away. There's not much you can do about that. You can't change a zebra's stripes. You gotta live with the zebra. And the same with the bass. Not only did they not have, I mean, they didn't have a bass. So of course we take the electric bass just for emergency cases like this. Now tonight I'm told that they have a bass. I hope it'll be true. In any case, the last two nights we changed the music completely. Played much more towards the rock type of stuff, you know, more like On the Corner and that kind of stuff. I started with because it was more suitable to the instruments. Bobby has a keyboard that like has all kinds of sounds and everything like that. And we were, by the way, this is a professional situation. You're pushed into a situation that you can't control. You can send a rider all you want and say, "I want my vodka there," and they'll give you what they give you. You know, moonshine. What are you gonna do about it? Now, either don't play the gig and make a scene out of it or not. So you're stuck with the equipment, and good musicians learn to adapt themselves and still be able to put out what they can with an upright piano, if you get my point. All right? So tonight, we hopefully will have the real deal. It's a real place, right? Okay, so we've been listening to Sonny Rollins. I just had to bring him up. I'm thinking about this too. Thank you.
Thank you.
else, of course.
Question?
Yeah.
You don't carry much instruments, you know, a string bass, but if you carry your own cymbals.
Yeah, cymbals. Cymbals, snare drum.
And snare.
Yep. That's de rigueur. Although we know guys who show up with just a bag of dumps. I think Joey doesn't bring cymbals.
Yeah, that's what you're saying.
Sarcasm.
Yeah, cymbals are personal. You know, it's your sound and it's easier to carry than the drums.
And sticks, right?
And sticks. And the snare drum, you can't count on to have a coated head or obviously sound like you want it to. You know, I mean, just
important. Yep.
It's important.
And you're using light sticks, I would imagine, more or less light.
They're medium light. There's lighter. You know, some jazz drummers play with lighter sticks, but these are kind of medium to heavy for a jazz stick.
Obviously, a pretty free approach to a classic tune. I think everybody in this room knows all those, what we call rhythm changes. And boy, if George Gershwin ever came up with a brilliant thing, that little 36 bar tune with the tag, a little tag on it. I mean, that is the, one of the cleverest progressions that has been, you know, launching point for hundreds of tunes, dozens of tunes, at least. And of course, the thing about rhythm changes, which is really intriguing, is that in a certain way, it kind of sums up all of tonal harmony for 400 years. Now, of course, I am exaggerating, obviously, but the whole idea of tonic, subdominant, and dominant, what we call 1-4-5, or in our language, 2-5-1, two being the same as the four, subdominant quality, and all the rules about voice leading and about tension and release, et cetera, number one. Number two, the bridge, middle part, I mean, it's really a 16-bar tune at the end. It's a melody three times, and then that bridge, which is really not even a melody for the bridge. That bridge is a series of dominant chords, fives of fives of fives of fives, and so forth. So it really, in a certain way, and then what's been done with it, what people have done with the progression, always from playing only B-flat pedal, I recorded with Richie, we played B-flat pedal for the whole A section, to like the diminished chords every two beats, et cetera, et cetera. It's quite an interesting thing. And of course, if you are interested in jazz improvisation, you have to deal with rhythm changes sooner or later. Sooner to get it over with. Because it is part of the qualifications to pass through to the other side. As is, of course, the blues, both a dominant major blues and a minor blues, of course, and rhythm changes. And then, of course, we go into what we call the standards and standard tunes and all that. Various degrees of standard tunes from There'll Never Be Another You to Embraceable You to Stella by Starlight, some more sophisticated than others. And I often get the question of how long does one have to play like this to be in school, so to say, and play the repertoire before they earn the right to play what they want to play. Well, first of all, you can do whatever you want to do. That's your business. But number two is there's a certain criteria that is learned through this repertoire that we call the standard repertoire, of which blues and rhythm changes are a major part. And it means that your ability to negotiate moving harmonies at any tempo and fluently make them sound like melodic lines that are the right notes of the choices you have, and there are, you could say there are 12 choices, but it's a little more limited when you're talking about a chord. And to be able to tell a story, in other words, some kind of tension and release graph, anything, as long as I get something from you. And to be able to do that, those changes, without the help of a bass line or a piano, if you're a horn player. If you're a piano player, right hand only. If you're a guitar player, single lines only. In other words, the ability to play through a moving progression at a decent tempo with feeling and swing is what we consider the groundwork of this music. And we all teach. And we all teach it in various ways, depending on the level of the student, depending on a particular outlook on how to do that. But you all know Jamie Abersold and David Baker, who just passed a few weeks ago. And you all know the books and all that stuff. And that the reason there's so much material on that stuff is because it's considered really mandatory. And there are musicians who haven't done it, maybe to the extent that others have. But if you're going to be honest about this music, you want to walk before you run. I remember I always tell the story about a Picasso exhibit in the early 80s at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art in Manhattan. And it was a retrospective. Of course, in his case, retrospective would fill the whole city of St. Louis. But this was enough to fill three big floors. And they take you through the red period, the pink period, you know, the instruments, the women, the self-portrait, blah, 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 all shit. And then at the end, because you got to follow the line when you're at a popular exhibit, you get to the end and there's a little room up a couple steps. There are only four or five people at a time going there. And when I get up there, it was whoever I was with, we go into the room, and it's a dark little room, maybe a quarter the size of this, with pictures, photos of the 10, I'm saying 10, it could have been 8, I don't know, classic paintings in art history. You know, Mona Lisa, obviously. But not even her. She, like, you know, like the Blue Boy, you know, Greco, and that was Tintoretto, La Primavera, and of course the Night Watch, and Starry Night, you know, Van Gogh, and blah, blah, blah. So it's like, the, you know, like it's like knowing the rhythm changes. Those are the standards. And then there's Picasso's version of it. And it's exact. Exact. You cannot tell the difference between Van Gogh and Picasso's, except I don't have Van Gogh in front of me. It's worth, you know, $2 trillion. But you got a picture of it and you see Picasso's. Now, Picasso probably did this when he was like 6 months old because he was so talented. You know, while he's in the bathroom, he's doing this shit. You know, I mean, he was a genius, he could do anything. But my point is this, I always use that example. You know, Picasso's known for his abstract, okay, really abstract painting and really starting, but being such an important voice for a different way to look at things in the early 1900s. He came out with that Demoiselle de Avignon. You see these girls with African sculptures, you know, it's a different way of looking at things, just like Schoenberg was a different way of hearing compared to Brahms from a couple of years before. Point is that when we teach this music, the repertoire, we're really asking a young musician to be well-versed so that they can leave what they know. They get it, they know it, and they don't have to do it again. And when we play Olio, which we never played in this group, we've all played Olio, but not in this particular setting, we look at it as a means to express ourselves in the moment harmonically, not rhythmically within the bounds of us setting tempo, at least at this moment. We could, that could change. But as far as the harmonies, Bobby's playing, and what Tony's doing, and then the way Matt played on it, the way I played on it, it's an abstraction of a piece, of this Gershwin progression, so to say. And we have the ability, because of our training, and they have it, to be able to jump across boundaries and still remain true to the song. Now, if we just played the head melody, and then left it and played completely free, why play the tune? You know what I'm saying? So if you're going to play a song, probably kind of mandates that you do something with it, and if you have enough knowledge, you can turn it into a piece of work, piece of art that's yours. Of course, it's not your publishing, it's not your tune, but it became your tune in the moment. That's the good thing about jazz. So the classical music, basically, outside of interpretation, we're going to hear the same notes. They might be, you know, diminuendo more today than yesterday, according to the menu that you're handed. But basically, the notes are going to be the same. And you know, this cat sitting out there with the score, like instead of going like, hit the F sharp, right? Yeah. It's because cats are checking, especially the opera, they're really checking. And of course, we don't do that in jazz. We live in the moment and treasure the moment and treasure whatever happens. And of course, things happen. It's not going to be a perfect piece because there is no agenda beforehand. The only agenda is, in this case, a progression of Olio that I chose to play, at least at the beginning, but then even that got discarded. So, this idea, this understanding of playing standards and everything that everybody in this room likes jazz and plays jazz has had to deal with. It's a hurdle that has to be, you have to climb over it. It's a mountain to be climbed, and not forever. You don't have to play that way forever, but you do have to sort of know it. And if you don't know it, there'll be holes in your training that will be heard by experts, if you care. Right? Yes, sir.
I listened to one recording artist. He kind of young in it, and but he double tones a lot of his stuff.
Yeah, good. That's a flute technique. Just another game. There's all kinds of stuff. We listened to, last night. Opening for us last night in Nashville is this great saxophone player. I think he's Spanish originally. Pedro, his last name is what? Sax. Pedro Sax. I mean, he played a tenor like 30 minutes in front of us last night. I had heard him once before when I'd been in Nashville last night. I mean, he was doing stuff on that horn. I have no idea what he was doing. I mean, mean, it was, some of it was otherworldly. I mean, there are people doing things on saxophone. There's some soprano players that are way out there. I mean, what they're doing. They are not playing Olio, believe me. They have not, they decided not to do that. I have total respect for them if they become masters of what they do. And there are some guys, there's a cat that I worked with a couple months ago. There's two guys, three sopranos. First of all, Sam Newsom, who's in New York, you might know. He's really good. He's doing some different stuff. And this guy from France, named Michel Doneda, D-O-N-E-D-A. And I never heard of him. He's 60s, my age, more or less, you know. I never heard of him until about 3 years ago. Somebody put something on. I go, what the? This can't be a soprano saxophone. It's impossible. So I hunted the brother down, got him to commit, had him in New York, and we played. And it was unbelievable. His whole way of playing, it was like another instrument. And yet, physically, it looked exactly like me playing. I mean, more or less. The horn wasn't coming out of his ear, it was coming out of his mouth. It sounded like it was coming from another planet, you know what I mean? So there are guys doing extracurricular activities on this horn, that's for sure.
The young man I'm talking about is Antonio Hart.
Yeah, that's a wonderful musician.
He gets some weird effects out of
it. Yeah, there's a lot going on with saxophone these days. It has definitely gone far in 150 years, that's for sure. I mean, saxophone is basically a pretty easy instrument to get a sound out of. And I think it's one of the reasons why it's been such a prime instrument for jazz. Because if we just sat here and named guys, you would hear in your head so many sounds. I could just name tenor players, you go, different sound, different sound. You can't, trumpet, piano, you know, you get 10 or 20, but I think we'd be here, we'd get 40 or 50 tenor players that you could say, yeah, Illinois Jacquet, I know that. Lester Young, I know that. Dexter, I know, Johannes, Wayne, Joe, Michael, you know, you name it. There's a lot of individual sounds on saxophone. I think it's because it's so easy to play. Basically, you slap a reed on it, you blow it, you want to get something out of it. I mean, you know, you're going to get something out of it. And you do, you can't slap on a reed and trumpet and get something out of it. Or violin or piano, you got to do a little training on piano. You know, it's not just, you don't just walk into it like that. There's always that. Anything else? Anything you'd like to ask us?
How do you figure out your phrasing?
Well, first of all, I'm going to ask you, even though you asked the question, I'm going to ask you the question. What do you mean by the word phrasing?
The space between what you play when you're playing it. You complete a thought when you're playing it.
Okay.
Or feels complete.
Yeah. I mean, phrasing is a big word. It's another one of those like cars, you know, beer, you know, like which phrasing is articulation, it's dynamics. It's the time feel, the way I play my eighth notes or 16th, whatever. In that case, I played a lot of stuff out of time, against the pulse. Phrasing is a catch-all word that just means the way it sounds by the way the guy's playing it in general. I think you're asking more specifically how the placement of the stuff and spaces in between and so forth. Remember, we're not doing this with an agenda. I don't know. I do know there's a B-flat chord available on bar one, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, there are certain things we know about Olio that we may or may not observe. But phrasing is, number one, experience, and number two, being able to do what others did. What I just covered in my talk. In other words, if you're going to get, you're going to talk about phrasing, you first got to know from masters what real great phrasing is. For example, Lester Young is incredible phrasing for the style he played, and Coltrane, and you know, we can name them, we know who they are. So the first thing you do is, that's why we transcribe solos and do it. Paul Damaris is here from Webster. He came to one of my classes, and he knows, a couple of my classes, he knows how much I stress and emphasize transcribing, exact transcription, where you sound exactly like the original. And you analyze it, you see, oh yeah, he started on the beat three, and he started on the and the four, and you go and do that. That's number one. Number two, phrasing is a matter of experience. You can't get phrasing by playing with a play-along machine. I mean, it's the best you can do in your living room.
I guess what I'm asking is, why do you say what you say on your
horn? Well, because I'm here, because I'm hired to do it here. Because he's paying. Otherwise, I'd be sitting in the summer. I'd be having a beer then. Why? I don't know. What I can talk about. It's my job. But if you are interested in phrasing, take the implications of your question, if not exactly what you asked. You copy those who could phrase. We have abundant information. They're all on the wall here of people who can phrase. And each one of them probably pretty different from the one before. Sound different, phrasing different. Where they start their notes, where they start their thoughts, and so forth. It's a big field. But mostly it's also experience. You can't get it too much from a book. You gotta play. And you gotta play with guys who understand phrasing. And who play and have been through it and play better than you play. Because if you're sitting next to it, I mean, there's nothing like this. There's this, there's records or whatever tape, whatever you got. And there's watching it on video. And that's all great and entertaining and great. But you're really, in this music, as much in life, until you stand next to somebody who's really good at it, you don't really get the point. You sort of get it, but you don't get the, you get the information from, that you can get from anything, but you don't get the vibe and the feeling and the why I do it stuff that you can't express. We were talking about sound. Well, this is even worse to try to express what feeling is and what it's about. Why? What is that, you know? But when you stand next to it, I had the privilege of standing next to Miles. And for me, in that period, I had played with some heavy drummers. I played with Elvin Jones for 2 years. I played with Pete LaRocca, if you know him. Jack DeJohnette, I mean, been around the block. Good piano players, Chick Corea, you know, Joanne Brackeen, my contemporaries. But I had never really been outside of a jam session, stood next to a horn, trumpet or saxophone or trombone, anyone. A horn player of that stature and experience of Miles. I had Freddie Hubbard, I sat in with Woody Short, you know, but that was like a, you know, gig, can't come up, can I play a tune, and he played a tune, that's different. But here I was standing next to a horn player who was, a life of music, I mean, a lifetime of information. Nothing to do with his perks and about the stuff we were talking about before, him looking in the glass, and adult music. I mean, you know, the guy definitely knew how to phrase, that's for sure. And had 50 years of phrasing in different periods, and we all know Miles' history, notwithstanding the movie, which is a little sidelight. We know that he had different periods, but basically he phrased the way he phrased all the time. You can only kind of be one thing. What you surround yourself with, that's a different story. You wear a different shirt, you look different, you are the same, but everybody gets another feeling from you. So if you surround yourself with different guys, like I do with these guys, because they're playing different from the guys I had before, you're going to sound a little bit different. But basically a guy phrases the way he plays pretty much after his beginning years, probably going to pretty much stay like that. So with that in mind, if you play next to a guy who has his case down and got it together and is a master of it and a one-of-a-kind master of it, not even like a cookie-cutter guy, because that's cool too. There's Sonny Stitt, there's all that stuff. But then there's like, you know, Jackie McLean, who nobody sounded like. I mean, I'm just naming guys in that era. And you want to be next to a guy that has that kind of experience, because that's a feeling you get that you can't get anywhere else, because that's not going to come through on record or in the audience. So phrasing is really about experience and about playing with guys better, and you'll be next to guys on your instrument if you can do it. If you're a piano player, it's just like standing in the back of a piano player, watch his hands. Best you can do. I mean, really trying to understand physically at least what's going on, let alone orally. At least physically we can see it. Anything else?
Thank you. Thank you.
Marine on piano. Tony Marine on the bass. Matt Dash Michelle goes back. And Alex. Once again, tonight you'll see he'll be playing some flute and clarinet. Alex plays frame drum. Tony, of course, will play both basses. We'll have keyboard and piano, I believe. So that should be interesting. We'll have a few more minutes. Anything you'd like to ask any of us? Not me, necessarily. Anybody got something for the brothers? Yes, sir, George.
A question back to your basics on the personal saxophone sound.
Yes.
How much do you think physical anatomy dictates one type of sound versus another, or predisposed towards one or not so much another?
I'll tell you the story on this. Phil Woods, where these guys come from and where I've lived for the last 30 years. They're from the Pocono area. Phil tutored them and took care of them. He played his horn for a minute, assistant, so to say. I had an interview, I did an interview. We used to have a magazine, an organization I ran, still run actually. We had a magazine, and I interviewed Phil Woods. That's always nice when a musician interviews. And I said exactly what you asked. I mean, is there anybody more identifiable than Phil Woods as lead alto in the world? When you say lead alto, you basically mean Phil Woods and everybody else. You know, certainly from the 60s, especially when there was so much big band, singers and so forth, recordings. So, I mean, this guy has a sound that's identifiable, you know, from another planet. So he's the perfect guy to ask this question, which is there anything you did that you can relate to me about how you get your sound? I mean, anything, practice anything, blah, blah, blah. He said exactly what you just said. He said, it is inexplicable. It is a consequence of anatomy. It's your chest cavity, it's your throat cavity, it's your lips, it's your jaws, your teeth, you know, blah, blah, blah. Of course, all the components, obviously, but we're all different, and that's exactly the point. And I think, go back to my earlier point, why the saxophone is so good for jazz? Because it embraces the physical differences. I'm not a trumpet player, but it looks to me like you got a lot to deal with here. I tell you, there's a lot to deal with in trumpet. I mean, I'm telling you, saxophone is like, it takes in your body into account. Now, that's not to say that there are things that, you know, if you can't do, you should be able to practice, so forth and so on, obviously. But he made that point, and here's a guy whose sound is identifiable to, you know, most jazz musicians and most listeners in the world. So I guess it's more than a kernel of truth in that it's a lot to do with the consequences of your anatomy. Not much you can do with that, really. But then, you know, there are, Joe Alex, that book that you referred to was Joe's thing. And Joe's main thing was, don't do anything to harm yourself. Don't do harm. And to play, he said, is an extension of the vocal cords, as in speaking, as in singing. If I speak to you and I put my hand here, it's moving all over the place. I don't speak in a monotone. How do I get different pitches? It does something in the throat. It's the larynx, it's the vocal cords. They do something. And they do according to the dictates of your imagination. If you say boo, it says boo back to you. And it moves. And we, as horn players and opera singers and public speakers, and in the case, athletics even, we have to train our body to do more than the normal person. We need to have a little bit more subtle use of this thing here, because I'm using it for my art, my life, my living. A normal person ordering cappuccino don't have to worry about it. So we can enhance and enable more to happen if we don't do things to block things. Joe's thing, this one was one. Another was tight corners, smile, lips. He said all the stuff that you read in these books about, you know, smiling and make a figure eight, not, you know, all the metaphors of how the way your throat should be and everything. He says it's complete bullshit. It confuses you. It makes you a nervous wreck. He said by the time you go to, he says, how can you play music if you got all that happening? He says you're supposed to be free. You're supposed to be able to imagine. You're supposed to be loose, especially in jazz. You're supposed to, quote, react, instigate and react. And you got to be worried about whether you're doing a coughing sensation in your throat. I mean, I'm of course exaggerating, but the point is, his thing was, there's nothing to do, but there's plenty that you can do to hurt him. And Joe's thing was, you went into him, it was like a doctor. He saw you had a cold, and he prescribed for you different than he prescribed for you, because your cold's different. You had different symptoms. But in the end, he was a repairman more than anything. He was just saying, it's a natural thing to play. Don't get excited about it. Don't do anything crazy, and it'll all come out. Sounds easier than it is, and it was to him. That was the point. But that anatomy thing is something we can't escape. That's your body. Good question. Yes, sir, my friend.
Dave, for you and Matt, do you recommend using the B flat, the biz key?
I learned using the side key, and that's why I do it. There's no other reason. I know guys who don't use this, and they use one and one, and they're cool.
Right.
It's what you're used to.
There's slight color differences
maybe, but they're all, you know, legitimate and they're cool. Maybe the side one isn't even as good as the other ones, but that's what I learned when I was 12 years old, so that's the one I'm stuck with. Well, it's the same in F sharp. There's a whole bunch of ways of playing high F sharp, you know. Sonny Stitt, in one of his kind of moments, came up to me and my partner with Elvin Jones, Steve Grossman. This was our first tour with heavies. The Giants of Jazz, Sonny Stitt, Dizzy, Monk, Blakey, you know, they're all there. And they're all in this dressing room of one big gig in Vienna, big gig, when everybody played, every group played, like a 6-8 hour marathon. And we're the only Caucasians in the room, so to say. And we're certainly the youngest, that is for sure. This is the early 70s. Sonny Stitt, now I didn't know that he's known for this. He comes up to me, and we're just sitting there, like, you know, being really cool because we're around Giants and, you know, we ain't carrying on, we ain't doing any of our little foolish stuff, we do on our own. Just being really respectful, really nice. You know, hello, Mr. Monk, good morning, how are you? You know, he didn't even answer, but no problem. he was like a walking dead, it was rough. And Sonny Stitt comes up, and I mean, out of nowhere, he like was hunting for us. I know it, I could see it coming. And this is a dressing room like a stadium type, and so it's like, teams, athletics, so it's like a dugout. I don't know, there's benches and everything. The cats are all over, they take shirts, drying up, sweat, drinking cognac, whatever. What kind of stuff going on? He goes, listen, you two guys, and he's shouting at us, you two, come over here. Yes, sir. He says, how many keys on the saxophone? Can you answer that question? Come on. I bet my repairman can't even answer that question. So we're both like, I think it's Steve. Maybe Steve knows something. I don't know, you know. And, you know, he said, and I got another question for you. How many ways can you play high F sharp? Now I could venture in and say, two? He said, you don't know nothing, and you call yourself saxophonist? And walks away. And the guys are laughing like hell. Like, there he goes again, there he goes again. And then, you know, I don't know how to take, you know, I'm completely crestfallen, I'm defeated. I'm defeated, I'll never be good. Sonny Stitt called me out, I should have known him. He said, saxophone, don't I know what I'm doing, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Down like this. And then, of course, it subsides, and, you know, whatever. Elvin comes over, he's called standing, watching this whole shit. He comes over, he says, you know he's famous for doing that. And don't mind his ass at all. He's just a spoiled child. Anyway, talking about how many ways to kill to play an F sharp or play a B flat. I still don't know how many different ways to play high F sharp. I got another story while I'm doing stories. This is another one with the masters. This was my friend, drummer Bob Moses. Some of you might know who he is. At a young age, was already in it. And he was playing with Rassan Roland Kirk, 18 years old, 19 years old. He was great, you know, he was trained already, good. He knew everybody. His godmother's Abby Lincoln, so you get the point. So I'm 18, 19, I'm friends, and he says, I'm playing in Philly, Showboat Lounge, famous club, and come in and sit in. What do I know? So I'm 18, 19, I could drive, so I had to be 18. I drove from New York to Philly, Saturday night, packed house, man, everybody styling, everybody looking great, mostly black, you know, out to have fun. I mean, you know, Saturday night, you're raising hell. I go to the dressing room, they're on a break, I go to the dressing room. You know, now Rassan, you know, was blind, so it's not like he sees you there, because he senses anything, of course. He said, somebody else here? So Bob says, it's my friend Dave's here. He says, yeah, nothing, not a word. They go up to play. I go, I don't know if he say anything. I just go up. I take the tenor and I go up. Then play soprano. I go up and play, take the tenor. Band set up. Saturday night, second set, which is the set, the money set of the week. You know, that's when they make their money for the week, basically, right? So everybody's like, this Rassan Roland Kirk. He's got all that stuff on. You know the pictures. He's got, you know, he's got chains, nose flutes. things hanging from it. It's like a hanging tree. Tape, and it's unbelievable. All kinds of colors and everything. And he's very flamboyant, as you remember, if you knew him. He plays his ass off. And so he's in front, and I'm over here near the drum, right back in the back, cool. He goes, "All the things you are, your first no step sharp. One, two, one, two, three, four." I had an out-of-body experience. I have no idea how I got through the next, what's a chorus at that tempo? 30 seconds? A chorus? Let's say a couple of choruses. I had no idea what key he meant, what speed he meant. I couldn't do it today. I don't know what he was doing. I have no idea what he requested of me. He just he played the melody, and then he went, pop, and like I do to him, I hand it off, bat, like that. I don't know what I played. I don't know what happened for that next minute and a half or whatever it is. It was by far the most embarrassing moments of my life. And, of course, the club was like, yeah, you got that little boy. Teach him a lesson, man. Well, that was, now I'm in the back. Now I'm not even there. I'm back here. Behind Tony. I'm at them, behind. And then finish the tune, and I'm like, I don't know what to do. Go off. I mean, it's embarrassing. I don't know what to do. And he, next song, he says, September song. It's Kurt Vile. I happen to know the melody. I didn't know the changes, but I could kind of fake my way through it. And he kind of looked at me like this, like, you played a melody with me. And I kind of got through it. I don't know how. It wasn't as bad as All the Things You Are. And then I left the place. And the lesson is, if you can't stand the heat, do not go in the kitchen. That is the story. And those guys lived by that creed. They were intent on continuing that up until their dying days, which was challenge time. If you can't do it, do not get up there. Now, those famous stories from Minton's in the early 40s when everybody was starting to get bebop together, and how, a lot of rookies would come up with Monk and Bud Powell, and, the main guys who obviously could do it. And these guys thought they could do it. And, they'd get up and the cast would play too fast for them to even breathe. Or put it up a half a step, or something to completely sabotage the poor cat who would then walk off and be like this. But there's a great Bird story from Stanley Crouch's book, which is really excellent, by the way. And it's about him sitting in at 14 years old in Kansas City with Joe Jones on drums. And in those days, they didn't like you, they thought you should get off there, they would do a ding on the cymbal, like on the bell, right? But really hard, clanky, come on, Bob. I mean, loud, clang, like that. It wasn't part of the drum sound. It was definitely a message to get them off the stage. So Bird's up, he's nervous as hell to play, and he gets up and he plays, and he starts playing Honeysuckle Rose, but he's in the wrong key because he thinks it's in concert D or something. Something about the alto transposing or something. So he's way out of it, And Joe Jones is dinging him. Dinging him, ding, ding. Maybe that's where Gnid comes from. It's ding backwards, right? He's banging the thing like this, and Bird is, eyes closed, trying to play and everything like that. It's cool, but he's not yet. He's not Bird yet. Joe Jones takes the cymbal off and throws it at him. Throws the cymbal at him, and not to do him harm, but to wake the guy up. And it lands on the floor, and Bird comes up like this. Get out of here, kid. Needless to say, 2 years later. Got it together. He practiced. There's a great interview. You can look this up on too. Paul Desmond interviewing Bird towards the end of his life, 54. Beautiful interview. And Paul Desmond, I don't know if anybody even knew him at that time yet. He's talking to Bird. He's Charlie. What did you practice? Close A scales. I practice clarinet studies on saxophone. Blah blah blah. Great stuff. He says, Bird, look, you found a new language. What you did was such a contribution. Blah blah blah. He said, you must have practiced a lot at some point. What can you tell me about that? Tell us about that. And then he answers, I can't do it, but his tone of voice is unbelievable. It's like the, King of England. If you can imagine, the King of England sound like that, maybe he doesn't. But, well, Paul, there was a period when I was about 13, 14 years old. My mama, she was quite upset with this, but I would be doing anywhere from 11 to 15 hours a day. Something like that, Paul. And Paul Desmond says, yes, sir, got it. Stories from the crypt. Anything else you'd like to ask us? Yes, sir.
No,
have any stories about Joe Allard when you were training with him?
Gentleman, scholar, the nicest guy, and very zen. He, again, he didn't tell you what to do. He just told you, don't go there. He was a beautiful dude. He looked distinguished. He had gray hair. He looked the part. And he came when I was in Elvin. He came to the Vanguard, met Elvin. And I'll tell you this last story before we go with Miles, because it's really a beautiful story. No, Miles was Miles. And at the end of the concert, we played Carnegie Hall. This is a record called Dark Magnus. It's a record now. It's available. And at the end of the concert, first of all, my parents were there. That was a big deal, because I was Carnegie Hall. That's finally when they saw that I'm cool. My mother said, you got to be good. You must be good if you're here. So meanwhile, Joe was at the concert. I invited Joe to the concert. This was a major concert in New York City. I'm from New York. I'm at Carnegie Hall, Miles Davis. I played there with Elvin, but this was a big deal. And so Joe was there, and I said, Joe, would you like to meet Miles? He said, no. I wouldn't bother the master. No. I said, Joe, you gotta meet him. He's cool. He'll love you. I'm sure he knows who you are. And I probably told him. So I take him backstage. He comes in, and you know, he's dressed like a professor of saxophone. You know, like beautifully dressed, tie, gray hair, looked French descent, Allard. You know, perfect French. And he goes back and said, Miles, this is my teacher, Joe Allard. Miles looks at me and says, I know you. Hugs, Miles, I mean, way out of his personality, you know, like not the normal hello, walk away, turn your back. He hugs and he says, you taught him and Steve, right? Gross, because Steve was with him a couple years before me. And he said, you did a good job. Yeah. We got some CDs if you're interested, and we will see you tonight. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah.
Bobby Andy, Tony Marino, Matt Bastian, and Alex Rich.
Well, Mr. David Lee.